بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه أما بعد يقول الحق تبارك وتعالى فلذلك فادعوا واستقم كما أمرت وقل آمنت بما أنزل الله من كتاب وأمرت لأعدل بينكم الله ربنا وربكم لنا أعمالنا ولكم أعمالكم لا حجة بيننا وبينكم الله يجمع بيننا وإليه المصير. This ayah was preceded by a couple of other ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes the lineage of this deen from Adam alayhi salam all the way to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he says shar'a lakum min ad-din ma wassa bihi Nuhan wallazi awhayna ilayk wa ma wassayna bihi Ibrahim wa Musa wa Isa an aqimu ad-din wa la tatafarraqu fi. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated for you in this deen, means that in the deen of Islam, that which he has commanded Nuh, our second father, and Ibrahim, the father of most of the prophets, Imam al-Tawheed, the Imam of Tawheed, and Musa, Isa, and Muhammad, alayhi salatu wassalam, meaning that these are the five ulil azmi min al-rusul, the mighty prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has named them as such in the Quran. أن أقيموا الدين ولا تتفرقوا فيه. Establish your deen and never divide in it. Also in Surah Yusuf we read in the Quran, قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني وسبحان الله وما أنا من المشركين. Say, O Muhammad, that this is my way of life. أدعو إلى الله. I call to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. على بصيرة. Underline. Ala basira means upon guidance, upon knowledge. Ana wa man ittaba'ani, me and those who follow me. And then we have other ayat in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa man ahsan qawlan mimman da'a ila Allah wa amila salihan wa qala innani min al muslimin. And who is better of a speaker, or whose speech is better than one who calls to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and acts upon that which they proclaim and that which they preach. وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا, they do righteous deeds. وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, and they say, I am among the Muslims. And the ayat in the Quran are endless. We're talking about the concept of da'wah al-Islam. We're talking about an obligation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to propagate the message of Islam. We talk about our intercessor, the one and the only one intercessor on Judgment Day that commands us to what? بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ بِآيَةٍ. Convey the message of Islam on my behalf even with one ayah. And it's very difficult sometimes being in the circle of the Muslims, in the masajid, listening to the tawheed and listening to the recitation of the Quran and listening to the words of wisdom and the words of guidance, to appreciate that which we indulge in, that which we enjoy, the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, you know, accurately. And one way to get a taste of this guidance is to confront the misguidance by way of giving the da'wah efforts. And we're in a da'wah session today where you listen to two speakers, one of them was a rabbi and the other one was a Muslim. And mashallah, with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, success only comes from him. The person who represented Islam said very good words about the Quran, establishing that this is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna al-deen 'inda Allah al-Islam, that the religion to God is Islam. وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ. And whoever seeks another religion aside from the religion of Islam, it shall not be accepted from him. وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And he or she in the hereafter are among the losers. They established the divinity of Islam, the divinity of the Quran. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's unlike any other book. It's a book of guidance. It's a book of wisdom. It's a book of science. It's a book of science. It's a book of facts. It's a book of history. It's a book of everything. Establishing that, and then the other person speaks. And the if in front of every time they say, if God is good, If God is perfect, if God is this, if God is that. And then talking about some issues that are prohibited in Islam, like homosexuality and abortion. And they say, yes, their books prohibit homosexuality, but it is for the rabbis to interpret what that means. Meaning that the rabbis can legislate and override that which they claim to be the legislation of God. And they can blasphemize God, and they can blasphemize His prophets and messengers, claiming that they also suspect that some of the prophets and the messengers of God were also practicing homosexuality. Listening to this, I started to look at the ceiling. I said, I hope it does not collapse on us tonight, inshallah. And I began to say and utter the words of tasbih. Because this is how you begin to appreciate the guidance and the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon you and I. When you begin to hear nonsense like this, when you begin to recite the ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَقَالُوا يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَ, and they said that the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is stingy. غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا. Their hands are stingy, and we witness them as such, and they're cursed by that which they fabricated against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It turns out what they fabricated against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not entirely mentioned in the Quran. No, they go beyond that. What they fabricate against the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divinely guided, those who are chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to His infinite knowledge and wisdom, what they fabricate against them in terms of lies is beyond imagination. It's beyond imagination. For subhanAllah, you wonder, what religion do they follow? What God do they worship? What hereafter? What reckoning day they believe in? So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these ayat that we mentioned at the outset of this talk, He says, فَلِذَٰلِكَ فَدْعُوا. When you hear all this vain talk and all this blasphemy and all these insults, and you sit still, do nothing, then you're not a Muslim. You're not a true Muslim. You're not a Muslim that obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We recite in the Quran about the story of those who've gone astray. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested them on the day of Sabbath, إِذْ تَأْتِيهِمْ حِيْتَانُهُمْ شُرَّعًا. When the big fish, they were, it's a town that was dependent entirely, its economy is dependent upon fishing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to test them. On the day of Sabbath, where they're not supposed to fish, the big fish will come surfacing on the top of the water. Is that easy to catch? And there's a test for them. And on the days where there's no Sabbath, the fish doesn't come, or comes in very, very small quantities. So they said, this is not going to work. So they made the net, and subhanAllah, I was seeing this every step of the way today. As they were saying, you know, there are loopholes in their Sharia, and their scholars, their rabbis, are invited to take advantage of the loopholes, just like they take advantage of the tax law, mashaAllah. SubhanAllah, what do you think of رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the Lord of all the worlds? Okay, so they invented the nets. So they would trap the fish on the Sabbath, right? And they would catch it on Sunday. And they perceived that to be perfectly okay. And SubhanAllah, you see these actions every step of the way. In the way they talk, in the way they behave, in the way they act, in the way they run their businesses. So you feel like the Quran is just alive. It's a book from only one entity, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huh? Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what He has created. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about them and how they behave and who they are and so on and so forth, and commands us not to follow. That's really the lesson and the words of wisdom for us, is that we cannot emulate, because these are deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, does not like and punishes for, promise severe punishment for. So now the people of the Sabbath are catching the fish on Sunday. So the town divided into three groups. One group is engaging in this sinful behavior. Do not catch the fish on the Sabbath, on Saturdays. They violated the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only that, they tried to go around it. Meaning that they tried to override the legislation. You see, if they caught the fish, we say sinful behavior. They ask for forgiveness, they repent, promise not to go back to it, feeling remorse, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them. But when they go around the Sharia, they don't see that they're doing anything wrong. They see that they're taking advantage of some loopholes in their Sharia. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the second group in a very يعني, eloquent manner and praising them and honoring them. وَقَالَتْ أُمَّةٌ مِّنْهُمْ لِمَ تَعِذُونَ قَوْمًا اللَّهُ مُهْلِكُهُمْ أَوْ مُعَذِّبُهُمْ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا. So this one group that's trying to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. And these are our brothers and sisters in the Millah. Huh? We are far closer to Moses, peace be unto him, than the Israelites. We are far closer to Isa, alayhi salam, than the Christians. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala settling the disputes among Muslims, Christians, and Jews by saying, إِنَّ أَوْلَى النَّاسِ بِإِبْرَاهِيمَ لَلَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. That those who wish to lay a claim and establish a lineage between them and Ibrahim alayhi salam, those who are more worthy of this claim, الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا, those who follow the millah of Ibrahim, the Imam of Tawheed. إِنَّ أَوْلَى النَّاسِ بِإِبْرَاهِيمَ لَلَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا وَهَذَا النَّبِيُّ. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, naming the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, and those who believe, meaning that the Muslims, those who believe after the coming of the message of Islam. So the second group is engaging now in what they're supposed to do, enjoin the good and forbid the evil. So they're giving advice to those who are practicing the sin and catching the fish on the Sabbath. Don't do this. This will bring upon you the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, you are trying to override the Sharia. You are committing a huge sin, so on and so forth. So a third group that is extremely complacent, just like unfortunately you see many Muslims now. You know, I just do my thing and I have nothing to do with everybody else. Uh-uh. That's not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَنْجَيْنَا الَّذِينَ كَانُوا يَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ السُّوءِ. So we save those who were engaged in what? Enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. وَأَخَذْنَا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا بِعَذَابٍ بَئِيسٍ. And we have overtaken those sinful, oppressive people with a severe punishment. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes no mention of the third group, the complacent one. In other words, they are not worthy of being mentioned in the Quran. They are not worthy of being mentioned. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَلِذَلِكَ فَدْرُ. Because of this, you must propagate the message of Islam. You must enjoin the good and forbid the evil. You cannot allow evil to spread and fill in the void, right? And just stand there in a complacent state, watchful. And this is not, of course, the situation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that spent 23 years from jihad to jihad to jihad, from a struggle to a struggle to a struggle, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uplifted to him as he chosen the all-high companion. So this is the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is what he did. فَلِذَلِكَ فَدْعُ وَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتُ. So here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has attained the knowledge, and then attained the wisdom and applied that in action. And he has set a sunnah for us to follow. He spent his entire life calling to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had no concerns for this dunya. And when he used to refer to this dunya, he said, حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ مِن دُنْيَاكُمْ. It was made beautiful to me, or it was beautified to me from your dunya. He didn't say my dunya, he said your dunya. Huh? And then he mentioned a couple of things. فَلِذَلِكَ فَدْعُوا وَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Do not follow their whims and desires. Whatever offers they make to you, you stand by the Qur'an and the Sunnah. They've made many offers to the Prophet ﷺ, which we all know. They made him offers to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 1 year, and for him to worship their deities 1 year. What a deal, huh? It's a great deal. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the all supreme, the all powerful, the creator, the eternal, the first and the last, the one that's beyond numeration, beyond, you know, glorification, to worship him side by side with the idols. Cannot hear, cannot speak, cannot benefit you, cannot harm you. What a diva. They offered him to marry the most beautiful women among them. And they offered him to be the wealthiest man. And they offered him to be a leader. And they offered him, they made so many offers to him. He came back to them with one answer. He said, by Allah, if they place the sun in my right hand, which is impossible, and the moon in my left hand, I will not let go of this message. This is the message that I live and die by. This is the message I live and I die by. And I take any chances, I take any risks, I sacrifice whatever needed to be sacrificed for La ilaha illallah, for which the heavens and the earth were created, for which approximately 124,000 prophets and messengers were sent. Many of them were killed for La ilaha illallah, for which they've sacrificed everything they had, for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created paradise and the hellfire for those who adhere to it and declare it and proclaim it and apply it to their lives, enter paradise. And for those who deviate from it or reject it, shall enter into the hellfire. This entire existence for La ilaha illallah. This is the only true proclamation that a Muslim makes. This is the source of all goodness. This is the source of any good deed. Why? Because the prerequisite of the acceptance of any good deed in Islam is La ilaha illallah. If you say that and you perform the good deeds according to the Sunnah of the Prophet, then you are upon the straight path. If you do not accept that and you deviate from the Sunnah, your deviation is upon you. فَلِذَلِكَ فَدْرُمْ وَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتْ وَقُلْ آمَنْتُ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ كِتَابٍ. I believe in every book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. And this is part of the statements we made today. We said, I'm closer to Christianity than you are. And I'm far closer to Judaism than you claim to be. And this is a true statement. As we mentioned, إِنَّ أَوْلَى النَّاسِ بِإِبْرَاهِيمَ لَلَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. You want to lay a claim and establish a lineage and a relationship and a connection between you and a prophet, follow them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrates the stories of many prophets in the Qur'an and how they dealt with their people and how they stuck to their commitment and how they stuck to La ilaha illallah and how they proclaimed it and how they lived and died by it in order to set examples for us to follow them. Follow all of them, which were perfected with one man, and that is Sayyid Bani Adam, the master of the children of Adam, that is Muhammad alayhi afdal salatu wassalam. وَقُلْ آمَنْتُ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ كِتَابٍ. We believe in all of these books, whether we know about them or we don't. وَأُمِرْتُ لِأَعْدِلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. In spite of that, I am commanded to be just and fair with you. So if you do not choose to follow the path of Islam, that is your choice, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says so in the Quran, as he says in the Quran, وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Proclaim the truth from your Lord. Whoever wills shall become a believer, and whoever wills shall disbelieve. But the consequences are to follow. إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ نَارًا أَحَاطَ بِهِمْ سُرَادِقُهَا وَإِنْ يَسْتَغِيثُوا يُغَاثُوا بِمَاءٍ كَالْمُهْلِ يَشْوِي الْوُجُوهَ. That we have prepared for the unjust, for the oppressors, for the disbelievers. Now, a hellfire, it's already prepared. And of course, in it, there are all sorts of colors of punishment, and so on and so forth. And another ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا إِكْرَهَ فِي الدِّينِ قَدْ تَبَيِّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيْبِ. I mention these ayat because oftentimes, the non-Muslims think because you are attempting to preach Islam and to convey the message of Islam and to convey La ilaha illallah, they're thinking that you're imposing your religion upon them, but that's not the case. We are commanded to perform a certain duty, and that is to convey the message of Islam. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us in the Quran and by way of His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La ikraha fi al-deen, and then He proclaims, there is no compulsion in the religion. And it's impossible to compel anyone to become a Muslim. Because by definition, Iman, مَا وَقَرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَنَطَقَ بِهِ اللِّسَانِ وَصَدَّقَ الْعَمَلِ. What is rooted in the heart, proclaimed by the tongue, and affirmed by the actions. How can I root any Iman in anybody's heart? There's no way. It's inconceivable, it's impossible. Okay? لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيِّ. There is no compulsion in the religion. Indeed, the truth is evident, and so is falsehood. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. So whoever disbelieves in a taghut, and a taghut, everything that transgresses the boundaries of Islam, it's called taghut. وَيُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ, meaning that you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a clean page, clean slate, no shirk, no affiliations of any entities, you know, along with or aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None of that whatsoever. And as you learn the Quran and the Sunnah, you apply. وَأُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ لِيُنْذِرَكُمْ بِهِ وَمَنْ بَلَغَ. This Quran was revealed to me to give you words of wisdom and to teach you and to explain things to you and to give you warning by way of this Quran. When the ayat and when the messages and when the knowledge reaches you, it's incumbent upon you to follow, to learn, follow and apply. وَأُمُرْتِ الْوَعْدِلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. So we still need to be fair and just with them. You hear things that make you burning inside as a Muslim, because it comes head on head with the aqeedah, with the creed, with the iman that you hold inside of you. But then we recall the command of the Prophet ﷺ. We recall the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تُجَادِلُوا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. So if they blasphemize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we do not blasphemize them or curse them out, because they're going to come back what? And practice more of that blasphemy. They're going to come back with more hatred towards Islam and the Muslims. But we need to hold still. Just like when the Prophet ﷺ was verbally harassed, when some of the Israelites used to say, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. As-salam means al-maut, death. Sam means poison. So they're wishing him death. So that had happened once in front of Aisha radiallahu anha. Zawj al-Rasul ﷺ, the wife of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard that, he said, "Wa alaykum," and upon you. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, "Wa alaykum as-salam wal ghadab wa 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 al-khir." And she began to say, "And upon you is poison and the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Mahlan ya Aisha." "Hold it, Aisha. Why are you saying this?" She said, "Ya Rasulullah, have you not heard what they said? Did you not hear what they said?" He said, "Did you not hear what I said? Did you not hear what I said?" Meaning that the Prophet ﷺ responded to them, but without cursing them out. He simply said, "Wa alaykum." So who do you think statement is going to be acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Those who are wishing him death? Or the one who is the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is saying, "And the same for you. And the same for you." So for us, we need to exercise self-restraint and respond to them by way of the Quran and the Sunnah, not turn it into a personal battle. وَلَيَّادَ بِاللَّهِ. So it takes a lot of, you know, self-control. It takes knowledge and education, because they're going to come to you from every avenue. But the good news is that among them, you will always find those who have inclination towards Islam. You know, one way or the other, they're just trying to authenticate the information that they're receiving. Oftentimes, they receive an information from the media which is far from the truth. And based on personal conversations with people who are interested in Islam, they said, "This is not what we hear on the media." I said, "What are you going to hear on the media? You're going to hear a crash course in the concept of tawheed and la ilaha illallah and the correct creed and Islam, of course. What you're going to hear from the enemies of Islam is nothing but ill talks about Islam, وَلَيَّادَ بِاللَّهِ. وَأُمُرْتُ لَعْدِلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. So justice is still required of us towards them. اللَّهُ رَبُّنَا وَرَبُّكُمْ. We still claim and proclaim, اللَّهُ رَبُّنَا وَرَبُّكُمْ. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us in the Quran, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا. All people of the book, let's come to terms that you and I, or you and us, as you proclaim to worship God, that we worship none but one God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا. If they turn away, فَقُولُوا شَهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ. Bear witness that we are Muslims. Now, if someone who is really displaying tremendous hatred and enmity towards Islam and the Muslims, and they come on with a very challenging way with this and that, we also have in the Quran the ayat that are going to deal with them and address them correctly. Right? Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the scholars name this as al-mula'ana, or al-mubahala, I'm sorry, al-mubahala. Al-mubahala, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commanded, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. If you're really standing beside what you believe in and what you proclaim, you know, as a person of any faith you choose to, and you want to challenge us, we say no problem. Let's call our children and your children, our spouses and your spouses, ourselves and yourselves, and then make supplication. O Allah, make your curse and your wrath upon the liars. We as Muslims, we have keen belief and deep conviction in our deen based on knowledge. We are guided upon knowledge. So we are willing to do this because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to. But that's not where we start. That's not where we start. This is like the last thing that we need to do. The last course of action that we can adopt with those who fiercely show their enmity towards Islam and they want to challenge us in our faith and in our aqidah and our creed and our deen. For those, you know, the answer still is in the Quran. And we stand by that. We stand by that. فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. Then going back to the ayat we mentioned at the beginning of the session, وَأُمُرْتُ لَعَدِلَ بَيْنَكُمْ اللَّهُ رَبُّنَا وَرَبُّكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our Lord and your Lord. لَا حُجَّةَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ. After this clear and convincing evidence has been descended in the Quran and in the Sunnah, and we proclaimed it to you, and we taught it to you, and we shared this information with you, and we've given da'wah to you, this is it, we have fulfilled our mission, just like the people who were forbidden, the people of the Sabbath, who violated the sanctity of the Sabbath, they were forbidden them from catching the fish on the Sabbath. They have fulfilled the mission. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِنْ اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. All you who believe, you are responsible for yourselves after doing your part. The stipulation, after the condition, is after you've done your part, after you conveyed the message of Islam, after you've given da'wah, after you've shown them the truth. Now you're only responsible for yourself. So similarly, the people of the Sabbath who are enjoying the good and forbidding the evil, they've done their part, so whatever errors, mistakes, sins have taken place, they're not responsible anymore. Similarly, we do the same thing. لَا حُجَّةَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ. We've conveyed the message, it's all we can do. We've conveyed the guidance that we have between our hands, the Quran and the Sunnah. The guidance, or the success to follow the guidance, which is the ultimate guidance, comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not in your hands, it's not in my hands. And that's what I was telling their leader today. I said, you're pretty close to Islam, just the way you're, you know, praying with us. He comes and he prays with us sometimes. He prayed with us here at the masjid. He reads the Quran. He believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in God, according to Surah Al-Ikhlas. I said, you're very close. I said, when the time comes, you're going to submit against your will. He said, no, there's no way. I said, it's not in your hands. Your heart, your soul, your body is not in your hands. It's not under your control. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if guidance is meant for you, you're going to submit against your will. Just like we heard from some of the brothers who embrace Islam here, they come and say, yeah, I began to learn about Islam, but I said, right off the start, there's no way I'll become a Muslim. And here they are, they've been Muslims for years, and they're praying, they're fasting with us, they're praying with us, they're doing all, yeah. So it's not, يعني ليس بأمانيكم ولا أماني أهل الكتاب. Guidance is not in my hands. It was in the hands of the number one man, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ليس عليك هداهم. Their guidance is not your responsibility. Your responsibility is to convey the guidance. But the success of granting guidance and leading to the straight path and submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many people at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam willingly embraced Islam, and some of them, they were dragged into Islam by the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not by way of the Muslims, not by way of the sword. Because we established it's impossible for one to become a believer by the sword, or by a weapon, or by coercing them, or by pressuring them. There's no way. You cannot instill Islam in anybody's heart. لَا حُجَّةَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ اللَّهُ يَجْمَعُ بَيْنَنَا وَإِلَيْهِ الْمَصِيرُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end, shall gather all of us and shall ask each and every one of us, have we done our job? Have we fulfilled our mission as Muslims? Have we conveyed the message on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ? Have we obeyed him when he said, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ بِآيَةٍ, convey on my behalf, even with one ayah, if we want to qualify for his shafa'ah, as he's the one and the only one who will be able to intercede on behalf of any believer, then you must obey him for you to qualify to his shafa'ah. اللَّهُ يَجْمَعُ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ وَإِلَيْهِ الْمَصِيرُ. Indeed, our final destination, which we are walking towards that destination every single day, and we're closer and closer every single day, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefit us, and to benefit us with that he taught us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to apply and convey the words of wisdom. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to live so long that we live as Muslims and to die in a state of Iman. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and to overlook our shortcomings. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the punishment of the grave and the hellfire. أقول قولي هذا واستغفروه سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.